brethren, I keep trying to fill the time as we wait for the resolution. But a couple of things you might want to take advantage of while you're here today in Elizabethtown Masonic Village. We have arranged with our brethren and friends at the Rooster Woodshop here on this campus. It's a wood workshop that is compromised of volunteers from the brethren that live on this campus. So we've arranged for them to be open between the hours of 2 and 4 today. We should conclude the program around 2 o'clock. So between 2 and 4, they will be open, and you can definitely go and check their work. They do sell their items. They only accept cash or check. They do not take credit cards. They do have an ATM machine. And do they take cards too? Oh, they take credit cards. That's great now. But there is an ATM machine downstairs, I also know. And let me tell you, if you're looking for a gavel or you're looking for something special or looking for tools for your lodge, that's you're not going to be disappointed. It's a very nice place, and they do a lot of good work, and they're all volunteers over there. So please try to make it over. If you head out from here and make a right, and you'll see it right at the hill on your right-hand side. And the next right, I believe, from there, you're going to be able to go and see the market, which is only open till, I believe, 3 p.m. today. So not much time for the market itself, and there's meats and different produce that they sell from. I believe, I was told, it's all generated within a 20-mile radius from this campus. So something to, if you're interested in that, to venture and see. I'm being told that we are on live stream at this time. Very well. Thank you. Thank you. Ladies and brethren, we are now in session. Like all our endeavors, we're going to begin with a prayer. I would like to call on Brother Peter Krause, past District Deputy Grand Master, to assist us in this invocation.
Great Architect of the Universe, we ask your blessing on this gathering and that the ideas discussed today may lead our fraternity to a greater understanding of your will and to the betterment of our fraternity and all whom it reaches. In your name we pray, amen.
So would it be. Ladies and brethren, please remain standing and join me in pledging allegiance to the flag of our country. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands. One nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Please be seated. Ladies and brethren, I bring you fraternal greetings from Brother Larry Dare, our Right Worshipful Grand Master, who couldn't be here with us, nor any of the Right Worshipful brothers that are traveling with him today into other Masonic activities, but he sends his love, his fraternal love, in regards to all of you. Today marks several Masonic events that are happening throughout the jurisdiction, District Deputy Grand Master meetings, some town hall meetings that are taking place today at the same time, so that's where our Grand Master is. Since December 27th, he's been a busy bee. Many of you have seen him in your jurisdictions. He's been traveling extensively with the Right Worshipfuls, and his message for this term, for his term, has been to ignite the light within. To ignite the light within each one of us. And in this beautiful message, he's really targeting us looking back at what made us as Masons in this country and in this state, what made us individual Masons and what made our lodges, and to hopefully be inspired by that, to look into our present and future status and start really diligently again working on making ourselves better. Better in every aspect of the word of the term. Better men, better husbands, better civil servants, better anything and everything that we can be at. So our Grand Master in that initiative and in alignment with the SCAR program here at the Academy of Masonic Knowledge has really asked every lodge in this jurisdiction to write a 1,000-word essay. A 1,000-word essay that speaks about the initial inception of your lodge. What made it come to life? Who were the main players? What made them decide, you know, we want to gather together and start a lodge? And to hopefully take lessons from that and inspiration from them. I'll share with you a quick story. My lodge in 1930, Fritz Lodge number 308, 25 brethren came together during the Great Depression. During the Great Depression, 1930, each one of them either took a mortgage on their house or put money from their pocket to have a home that they called the lodge. And many examples and many beautiful stories throughout the jurisdiction that I'm sure you all can be inspired by and can be looking back into for inspiration. With that, I would like to welcome the members of this academy and to introduce them to you at this time. Our liaison for our Grand Lodge, the liaison between the academy and the Grand Lodge, is Brother Lynn Bud Baker, our Right Worshipful Junior Grand Warden. Unfortunately, he could not be with us today, but he also sends you his fraternal love and greetings. Also, the brain behind this operation and my partner in crime, the co-chair of the Academy of Masonic Knowledge, is Brother Seth Anthony, who is sitting over there in that corner. And if we have a brain, we have to have a heart, and that would be Brother Peter Krause, our past District Deputy Grand Master, who is the secretary of this academy, and keep us all in line, as every good secretary should do. In addition to that, we have a few emeritus members that are not with us today, Brother George R. Haynes and Brother Teddy Chick, who are past chairmen of this academy. In addition, we have Brother Austin Sherfin, who's with us today, Brother Vince Christiani, who's helping in the back with our streamlining, Brother Scott Mueller, who you all kind of went through him this morning in order to register, among others, Brother Mike Moran, who is sitting in the back, and Brother Bill Britton. In addition, we have a few brethren that are not with us, unfortunately, today for the various reasons that I explained and business that they have in their schedule today in the commitments. We have Brother Eric Krokstad, Brother Vince or Nicholas Vitis, and we also have Brother Erastus Z. Allen, who couldn't make it today. So please give them a round of applause. Also, we have a new member of the academy that could not join us today, Brother Brian Woodard, who is the newest member of the committee of the Academy of Masonic Knowledge, and he will be, again, assisting in the scholarship program in the reviewing of the papers and the work that is submitted by the candidates or members of this academy enrolled in the scholarship program. Ladies and brethren, at this time, we will recognize the district deputy grand masters that are with us in the room and any past district deputy grand master that is also with us in this room. If you may rise at this time, and please be recognized. Please give them a round of applause. And right now, we're going to also recognize the brethren who have achieved the milestone or completed the program. So as I call upon your name, please advance in front of the podium below. For level one completion, Brother Kevin T. Springman. Brother Brennan Tyler Stiffer. Also for completing level one. For finishing the program, completing the whole program, all three levels, it is my pleasure to introduce Brother Michael P. Goyen, Master Scholar. Congratulations, brethren. You know, there is really a unique happening today with us. It is probably the highest number of attendance by the ladies that are with us today. And if you may rise at this time and please be recognized, we're so happy to have you with us. We're so proud that you're here supporting us. We cannot do anything in this fraternity without your support and your love. So we really appreciate it. Please rise and be recognized by the brethren in the room. Thank you, ladies and brethren. At this time, I'm going to hand it over to, as I mentioned, my partner in crime in this academy, Brother Seth Anthony. Thank you.
Good morning, brethren. If it's time for me, it's time for speakers. That's a good thing. First up on the docket, it's my pleasure to introduce to you Brother Brett Gordon. And Brett, if you want to start approaching. Brother Gordon has been a member of the Masonic fraternity for over 35 years. He has served as worshipful master of lodges in both the United States and Canada. He is a past Grand Commander of the Grand Commandery of Florida. He's an avid golfer and loves traveling with his wife and kids to exciting new places. I think that includes Elizabethtown, Pennsylvania, as of today. His love of masonry and travel is matched only by his interest in heraldry, which began when he joined the Order of De Molay in his teenage years. He's a founding member of the Society of Scottish Armigers and is a longtime member of the Heraldry Society of Scotland. His coat of arms was matriculated to him upon the death of his father by Lord Lyon of Scotland. I now invite Brother Gordon to take the stage and begin his presentation entitled Heraldry and Masonry, A Story and Symbols, if you would welcome him.
Am I okay? Perfect. I'm going to act like Madonna for a second and have this walking mic so I can talk to all of you. So thank you very much for inviting me here. It is a pleasure. First of all, I want to thank the Academy and Seth and Yasser and all the people who said that this might be an interesting topic to talk about. It is a passion of mine. I really do like heraldry. I'm certainly not a herald or a heraldic expert, so if you have any questions at the end when we come back after lunch and you start asking me specific things, I'm going to give you the shrug of, I don't know. It's just something I've found fascinating since a kid. How many De Molays do we have in here, by the way? Senior De Molays, former De Molays? Okay. So as he mentioned, I really got interested in heraldry in my time in De Molay, because in De Molay we talk about Jacques De Molay and the Knights Templar, and you see knights with shields and different color shields and different symbols on the shields, and so that always fascinated me. I'm very happy to also find that all the ladies are here today, because while men are interested in heraldry for all these gallantry things we talk about, it's the ladies who appreciate the artistic aspects that we're going to show. And actually, I'll mention something in my talk about your the Academy of Masonic Knowledge, your banner here, because I found it very fascinating, and we'll talk about that in a second. So thank you very much. I did notice, and I was talking to my co-presenter, who Brother Sheldon, he obviously, if you know, he's a magician, so you're getting the university professor first. We'll just have 200 slides, not a problem. He's going to be pulling rabbits out of his hat, so if I disappear on stage or there's a trap door, trust me, don't worry about that. I did notice that there's a lot of you guys in the back. So if it's like a bus to school, I'm assuming you guys are the troublesome children, and you guys in the front are awesome. So I'll be talking to you guys in the back to make sure that you're paying attention and everything. Okay, so let's get started here. Hopefully you can see that. That's just what I want to do. That's my agenda for today. So I really want to talk about what heraldry is, a little bit about its origins, the term bucket shop heraldry, which for those of us who are into the heraldic arts, I'll explain that to you. I want to talk about heraldic authorities around the world, the different authorities that controlled the heraldic arts, and really what it means to have a coat of arms. I'd like to talk a little bit about the basics and the idea here that one man, one coat of arms. So how many of you have a family coat of arms? You don't have a family coat of arms. There's no such thing as a family coat of arms. If you have that thing that if your name is Gordon, like my last name is Gordon, if you have that coat of arms that says Gordon on the bottom, that's a coat of arms that somebody with your last name had. That's not your coat of arms. There's no such thing as a family coat of arms. A coat of arms is for one person and one person only, and if you have a son or a daughter or multiple sons, we differentiate those coats of arms for them and your firstborn son. would take over your coat of arms upon your death. It was mentioned in my thing that when my father passed away, his coat of arms was matriculated to me. So before that, I had a different coat of arms, and I'll show you mine and my son's and how it works and so forth. So one coat of arms for each person. Corporate arms, like what this would be considered, we'll talk about that. Oops, let me go back here. Grand Lodge arms. I've got a couple of decent pictures of Grand Lodge arms from around the world. You'll see how we've incorporated those and how many base their coat of arms off one another. We'll talk a little bit about Provincial Grand Lodge, Lodge arms, and so forth. I've got some interesting arms from some past Grand Masters of the Allied Masonic Degrees. For those of you that know Matt Dupay and Glenn Cook, they are both, actually Glenn Cook and I were founding members of the Society of Scottish Armigers. So I've got his arms, which are really nice, from Scotland, and then I've got Matt Dupay's from England, which are a very nice coat of arms. And then we'll talk about pennons and banners and table flags, and we'll end it there. And if you guys have any questions, I know we're going to have a Q&A afterwards, but please feel free to just stop me midway. I teach a lot at universities, and that's my full-time job, so I'm always being interrupted to talk. It's not an interruption. It actually keeps you from forgetting what your question was and probably will make me better explain something I'm talking about, so... we'll go with that. Okay, so first of all, I wanted to talk about Freemasonry, because it's not just about heraldry, it's Freemasonry and heraldry. So what is Freemasonry? I've thrown a couple of definitions up here for you. You know, we have the oldest fraternity in the world, outgrowth of operative Masons, the cathedral builders, a progressive science of morality, and then one that we most often hear, it's even in our ritual, a system of morality veiled in allegory and illustrated by symbols. So what does that mean? That means we don't have one definition for Masonry, that Masonry can mean many things to many different people. You talk to somebody, if they're going to tell you this, you talk to another person, they're going to tell you that. It's kind of like heraldry. Heraldry is different depending on which country of origin you have. The Japanese culture has their own type of heraldry. If many of you, like myself, are re-watching, I was a little kid when it first came out, but Shogun, that's on, I think, FX now. And you see all those nice, pretty banners. Those are heraldic coats of arms, for lack of a better term. It doesn't follow the rules that we would think of in England or Scotland or Wales or Ireland or even in Canada and places like that, but it is a form of heraldic art. So heraldry is different to the person you're talking to. The one thing I'll ask you to keep in mind is Masonry, we say, is, and forget about the veiled and allegory, it's a system illustrated by symbols. That's all heraldry is. It's just a way to convey something to others when they see it, especially on the field of battle or in something where that would be. Now, we have two things here, which I'm sure everybody here is familiar with, the common gavel and the 24-inch gauge. And what do we say? We say, and I'm not giving away any secrets, I promise, that, you know, we're using this gavel and we're making ourselves a better man by chipping away at our imperfections. And we're using the 24-inch gauge as a measurement of time, how to divide our times and so forth. So those are not what those are for, right? What is a gavel for? It's just, you know, it's a judge's tool. Stand up, sit down, keep quiet. It doesn't represent what we say it represents. It only represents that Masonic symbol because we say it does. The 24-inch gauge, that's how I just measure whether my bookcase is going to fit in there or how tall I am or whatever the question is. It's not something that we should use to divide our time throughout the day and how we're going to spend it. It's only because we, as Masons, say that. So it takes on a symbol. If I were to ask you right now, if I said, think of a pen. Well, that idea of a pen, a writing implement, I know what pen I'm thinking of. It's the pen that my wife gave me when I got my doctorate and so forth years ago, and it's nicely engraved. That's not what you were thinking of. So you think of things based on just the words I use, just like if somebody said gavel, it doesn't really mean what we say it does. To our fraternity, it does. So I want you to keep that in mind as we go forward. Now, what is heraldry? I've pulled a few quotes here from different sources. Burnett and Dennis in 1997, they wrote a great book on heraldry, so they're considered heraldic authorities, and they say heraldry is the fusion of fact and fantasy. Interesting. Fact and fantasy, myth and manner, romance and reality. It's the exuberant union of family, art, and history. It is the enduring, triumphal marriage of man and symbol. So again, we have that word, the symbol. Now, if you look at Friar, a little bit, he wrote the Dictionary of Heraldry in 1987, a little bit more drier book, obviously, a dictionary. He just says it's the art of depicting armorial devices in paint, line, stone, glass, etc. Kind of a boring definition. But here again, we have two, not contrasting, but two very different descriptions of what heraldry is, just like we had different descriptions of what masonry is. Now, if we look at this next one, that Macmillan Masonry is actually a stonemason's firm in Scotland today. And they say it's the poetically referred to as the shorthand of history. Interesting, shorthand of history. Used to symbolize the proud heritage, achievements, aspirations of individuals and private organizations alike. These are guys that are actually building or rebuilding the cathedrals. If you go throughout Scotland and probably England and Ireland and those places, they hire firms like Macmillan to help rebuild the architecture that's been damaged over time. Now we talk, I have got two other things. One says it's a science, right? It's a science with specific rules and language governing how a specific piece of heraldry is described. Well, that's masonry, right? Masonry is a science. We have very specific rules in how we do things. Keep in mind when I say a piece of heraldry, that's the coat of arms, that's the whole thing, the achievement. And how it's described in written words is called its blazon. We'll get to that in a second. It's an art. It's the written language and rules are in most cases very strict, but the interpretation of how the words are used to describe the achievement can be depicted as up to the artist. So again, masonry in the United States has 50 different flavors, plus DC and Puerto Rico and all the little outskirts. And around the world, it's completely different, right? I was amazed to find out when I sat down, and I've known Seth for a while, but we started talking, that your district deputies, to be a past district deputy, 5 years. Right? That's unheard of in Florida. It's a one-year term, and you're a past district deputy, and you're a right worshipful. Those guys are right. So just because we're all Masons, we operate a little differently. Just because there are strict rules, because you would assume those rules are very strict in Pennsylvania, it's not our rules in Florida or California or someplace else. So it's an art in the sense that there are some strict rules, but depending on who you're talking to, we can bend that a little bit. We can make it shape to our will. So I've got two coats of arms here, and these are both, when I did this talk originally, it was Queen Elizabeth, now it's King Charles. So these two coats of arms depict King Charles. They are his coat of arms. They obviously look different. Didn't I say one man, one coat of arms? Well, it's a little different for the king or queen. They can sort of do what they want, right? We know that. So can anybody tell me why this one over here? I think I've got a laser pointer. I don't want to cause retinal damage to anybody, so let me... Anybody tell me, I don't even know where they go. Oh, nope, that didn't do it. All right, we're not going to do the laser pointer. Can anybody tell me why this one is different from that one? What would be the difference? I'll pick somebody in the back row, but they're just going to ignore me because I really can't see because my contacts aren't that good, so I'll pick somebody in the front row. Any clue of why they'd be different? No? Okay. Nope. Good call, though. Good call. This one depicts the king when he's in Scotland. This one over here depicts the king when he's in England. And you'll notice, and I wish I had the point, I wish I had the little laser here. I really do. That was so cool. Is that the, nope, wait a minute. Ah, okay, there we go. This one over here, and you guys probably can't see the laser in the back. This one over here in the first quarter and the fourth quarter have the coat of arms of Scotland, the rampant lion, on a gold field. And England is over here. If you'll notice, in both of them, Ireland stays the same. But the first and the fourth quarters change. And that's not all that changed, but we'll talk about it. In England, the Lions of England, the three Lions of England, or as we affectionately from Scotland call it, the Leopards of England take preeminence. If you'll notice, the little buckle that's going around it, Honesoike Malipense, that's the symbol for the garter, or the garter. So that's around it. This, which you can't probably see too well because it blends in with the green, is the Order of the Thistle, which surrounds, that's Scotland's highest order of chivalry, which surrounds it. And then you've got the, on the preeminent side, over here for Scotland, you have the unicorn, which is Scotland's mythical beast, and over here you have the lion, and they're just reversed. Over here they use the crown of Scotland, over here they use St. Edward's crown. So depending on where you are, you know what, in essence, where the king is. If you're seeing this, you know he's in England. If you see this, you know he's in Scotland. So, as we mentioned before, it's a way for the masses to understand something depicted in art. How does that relate to Freemasonry? Well, if we believe our stories, our legends, where it came from the guilds, we have to teach people who may not always have been extremely literate things. So we teach them in symbols, right? So that's all this is. This is just a symbolic way to tell you something that's happening. The origins of heraldry are pretty ancient. I mean, we see this thing that it goes all the way back to the 9th century BC. But it wasn't this concept of hereditary or familiar arms. So somebody had a coat of arms or a symbol that represented them, but it wasn't necessarily passed down to their children. So it wasn't really a hereditary familial thing that we see now in the Middle Ages and maybe a little bit before Middle Ages. It's really about the 1100s when knights began to wear that full-figured face mask where I couldn't see you in battle. So I have to know you're friendly, because when there's hundreds of you attacking me, I have to know friend from foe, right? So this way I know, ooh, I know that's Johnson over there. I know that's Smith. I know that's Gordon, because I can look on the coat of arms and see that you're friendly forces. It's even mentioned, in theory, in the Holy Bible, and it says, "And the children of Israel shall pitch their tents, every man by his own camp, and every man to his own standard." So standard's just a flag that has its coat of arms. So even in the Bible, they're talking about every man, the children of Israel, shall pitch his own standard with the ensign of their father's house. So it's showing some type of allegiance to a group. In Scotland, you'll often hear people say, oh, my family clan, my family clan. Well, a lot of coat of arms, and you'll see mine, when we talk about the Gordon, the Marquess of Huntly, who's the head of the clan of Gordon, or House of Gordon. Gordon's not an actual clan because it's not from Scotland originally. He's got a coat of arms that represents him. All Gordons that theoretically have their own coat of arms, it won't look like that, but it'll have certain items that will make you recognizable as another Gordon. So here I've got some pictures. This is just, I think, from one of those medieval reenactors. They just show shields. So this is, if these were the people you were in battle with, you would know who was friend and foe because you live with these people. It was important to remember who they were. Just like you would recognize different military units from the United States, you wouldn't go, well, I don't recognize that guy, I'm a Marine, who's he? You know, oh, that's an Army, that's Navy, that's Air Force, that's Space Force, that's Coast Guard, and you know the difference between our guys and the guys who are on the battlefield opposing you. Bucket shop heraldry. When I asked all of you how many of you had a family coat of arms, this is probably what you were referring to. You got this nice little patent here that's frameable, and it's got all these coat of arms, and it looks really official and stuff like that, and you can buy them for like $30 on eBay. This is what we call bucket shop heraldry in heraldic circles. It's they've taken some coat of arms, and a lot of these you'll get with your coat of arms and then maybe your wife's coat of arms, and you'll put them together. Ooh, we got married. That just means somebody had your name that had that coat of arms, and somebody decided to make a buck off of it, and so they sold it to you. So that really isn't your coat of arms. And I have friends that put that little coat of arms, they'll get it emblazoned on their sheets of paper that they write letters to, and when they send out invitations, and I feel so sad because I don't want to go up to them and say, yeah, that's not really yours. It's not something you should be doing. But they do it anyways. But if you have this, save your money. It's okay. Nobody's going to make fun of you. But if you don't have it, don't buy it because it doesn't really represent anything. The way to get a coat of arms, at least for the majority of us in this room, and there's other ways to get it, is to go through England, Ireland, Spain, Canada. In the U.S., we have some stuff. I'll talk about that. But in Scotland, the two major authorities are Lord Lyon, King of Arms, which is Dr. Moreau, is the current King of Arms of Scotland. In the name of the king, or in previous, the queen, he grants all arms. He makes sure that if you are the son of a baron, a viscount, a duke, or whatever, and that duke dies and you're going to take his place, he actually certifies that you are the legitimate heir to that that title. And when I pass away, my son will have to prove that he's my legitimate heir to take over my coat of arms to Lord Lyon. In England, it's called the Garter King of Arms. Very much the same thing. The only difference in England, women can inherit titles. In Scotland, men can inherit, or women can inherit the titles, but they have to keep their paternal name. So in essence, if my daughter, if I had a title, my daughter were to inherit it, if she got married, she couldn't change her name, and her firstborn son would have to keep my name to inherit the title. If she changes the names, the title goes away, and it goes to a different person. So Scotland's very strict on all this good stuff. In Ireland, there's the Chief Herald of Ireland. The joke used to be, up until recently, as long as you gave him a couple of bottles of good whiskey, you would get your coat of arms, and it would vary in price. Nowadays, they do have a good heraldic authority that you can go through and get it. Canada, very much the same, Canadian Heraldic Authority. Spain, the Cronista Ray of Arms of Castile and Leon, that comes under the Spanish crown. If you can show that you have any type of Spanish heritage, you can petition and get a coat of arms. It used to be that because Florida was a Spanish colony at one time, if you were born in Florida and even had no, I mean, you could be Russian, but you were born in Florida, you could petition the Spanish Court of Arms for a coat of arms to be granted to you because you were born in a former Spanish colony. So interesting. America, we only have three real heraldic authorities. Two of them are self-governed. The first one is the American College of Heraldry. Great group. They will help you obtain a coat of arms. The American Heraldry Society, that's more of a historical hereditary society. They will also help you trace a coat of arms if your family had one. And then the only real one, and they've got anybody from the Army, former Army? Okay, thank you for your service, all of you. The Institute of Heraldry, which is a department of the Army. They don't do any personal coat of arms, but any insignias that the Army, the Navy, the Air Force, Marines, any military or governmental agency has to go through the Department of the Army to their Heraldic Institute to have their banners made, their coat of arms registered, all those type of things. It's not really looked at as heraldry, but it is a heraldic authority, and they are the Institute of Heraldry, which comes out of the government. This is where, and I promise we'll tie this into Masonry, I really will, I'm just giving you some background stuff. Grants of arms, immatriculation of arms, and assumed arms. Grants of arms are only from those places that I mentioned, Scotland, England, Ireland, Canada. There is South Africa and Malta and a couple other places. There's even a Russian one that you can get. But they're the only legal authority allowed to grant you a set of arms. Matriculated arms come from if you have a grant and you inherit them. So my arms, to me, were matriculated, but they were granted to my father. Everybody else, and most Americans, fall under the assumed arms, which means you just said, ooh, I like this. This is a good coat of arms that I've developed or had somebody develop for me, and if you go through the American College of Heraldry, they will develop one that is meets all the required standards of England, Scotland, Ireland, or Wales, and Spain, and then you just assume them. You register them. They're registered, but they're not protected by any type of law. In Scotland, which still has Lord Lyon, King of Arms, he runs what's called Lyon Court. It's an actual legal court. Anybody remember years ago Donald Trump? He has that big shield with a T in it that he used to put on all his properties. He bought a golf course in Scotland, put that flag up as a symbol. He got sued because he had never been granted arms, those arms from Scotland, and he was required to take them down because you can still sue somebody for using your arms improperly in Scotland, and there have been some cases where people have sued over them because they do mean that anything attached to that is your personal property. So there are some actually Lord Lyon and all the people who work for him are actually lawyers. You have to be a lawyer to be in Lyon Court. So assumed arms, you would just, in essence, just find a coat of arms that you like and assume them. So the coat of arms itself, what are they? Most people call it a crest. The crest is actually only that top part, which I'll show you a real depiction of one. That little top part, it's usually a beast or an animal or some type of device that you may put on a signet ring. The rest of the entire arms is actually the achievement or coat of arms. The D there, which is that mantling, which is all nice and flowery, you don't actually, it has no meaning. It's just nice color and little backdrop, and it's the artistic license of whoever's drawing your coat of arms. The shield is the main part. That's where it's all the good stuff is happening. That's where our main thing. And then the motto down on the bottom on the scroll, usually it's a family motto or some type of motto that you've picked that represents you and that you would want representing your family going forward. I'll talk to you about mine and how it was derived and how it derives from the Gordon motto and so forth. In Scotland, interesting thing, if you ever see the motto on top, that's probably a grant of arms from Scotland. The rest of the world uses the motto underneath the shield. Now, this is where we get into where it's a little bit of tie of Freemasonry. Remember how I said the gavel is really just a gavel? It doesn't mean anything. We just give it meaning. So the colors and their meaning, they really don't have any meaning, but a lot of people attach meaning to them because, again, we're trying to convey something, just like we're trying to teach a lesson in Masonry with the various tools that come with each degree or different symbols that we depict. The colors sort of have some type of meaning held to them. So if you were, and you can see We call them by their Latin names. So gold is ore, silver is argent, red is gules, blue is azure, green vert, sable, things like that. When they're in the written form in your depiction of your arms, but they have a sort of a quasi meaning. So we get people who were police officers, and they want to, you know, depict their coat of arms. Normally, it's going to be in some type of blue because you can see it has something over there to do with justice. It may be truth and loyalty, so they may have blue in there, purple for justice. It may be where do we have something like the warrior. So there's some red because maybe there are a lot of military guys always have red in there somewhere because of the aspects of war. Maybe they go the opposite way and they want white because they've seen war. It's horrible. Nobody wants to be in war. So they want to depict themselves as a peaceful person that was caused to go to war. So they'll choose white. These are not true in everything. I can guarantee you some of these things are not true for 90%. But when somebody's designing their arms, they may refer to these because it's a common theme that we think of in the United States, in England, and most Western civilizations, that these colors are usually associated with these attributes or traits that we want to depict as ourselves being. Now, here is the Gordon coat of arms. The first one is the major achievement from the Marquis of Huntly, Charles Gordon. I've met him, nice guy. He and his son used to own a little distillery which produced awesome scotch. So unfortunately, they don't own that distillery anymore, so I'm sad. But that is his coat of arms. Now, it shows, if you look at this one over here on the right, that's the actual original Gordon coat of arms. It's called the Lesser Achievement. It's got the three boar's heads. Comes from the legend of a Gordon was out hunting, and the king or leader of Scotland at that time, probably not the king, but the leader of Scotland at that time, was out riding his horse, fell off, and three boars attacked him, and the Gordon rushed in, killed them with just a knife, which if you've ever hunted wild boar, that's a good legend. You're probably not killing three boars because they're kind of ferocious. But for that, the king rewarded him, or the leader rewarded him, saying, I'm going to put the three boars, and that will ever represent Gordons for their ferociousness, and their tenacity, and their bravery. And up at the top, you see the coat, and both of them, you see the symbol, or the word bidand. That word bidand means remaining steadfast, remaining faithful, remaining true, and it's supposed to be the loyalty that first Gordon shows. So every Gordon after that is depicted as being loyal and true, and I'm sure throughout history there's some Gordons that have been scoundrels and have not been true, but we all try to live up to our family motto. The crest, which is that, and it can be depicted either way. Remember I said it's artistic license. So in this one over here on the right side, it's to the side, only depicting that. This one, it's to the front, depicting the whole head of the stag. It's because where the Gordons came from, which is around Aberdeen, there's great hunting there, and there was a lot of deer and so forth. So that's just been a symbol of the Gordon clan ever since. The other depiction here, so you see this one on the right is the actual Gordon coat of arms. It's in the first area over here. These other coat of arms are depicted of areas that the Gordon Marquis over time, over centuries, has acquired. So it's either through marriages or depictions of land. I'll be honest with you, I forgot what some of these are, but these are famous houses that basically have been absorbed into the Gordon household. So when he's just normally writing to you or something, it may be just this one, but this is the one that they're going to use if he was doing some official capacity, because this represents all his titles and all his good stuff. So remember the three boar's heads. We'll get that into a second. This is unusual also because, as I mentioned, all Scottish grants have a top side, a little scroll there depicting the motto. This one also has a bottom one. So it's just the secondary motto. And I don't read Latin, but it's always remaining, not astute, but I forget what it is. Somebody who's a Latin scholar, help me out there and Google it for me and tell me what it is. But it's got both mottos, so a primary motto and then a secondary motto. Most coats of arms in Scotland only have the primary motto, and that's it. So you can tell he must be a person of importance, obviously a marquis. This is my coat of arms. As you can see, it's got the three boar's heads, completely different arrangement and so forth, so it has nothing to look exactly like, but it's got the three boar's heads. This one, I said, was granted to my father, so let me give you a little history on this one. My father was a World War II vet. He was a Marine, United States Marine, fought in Guadalcanal He was a gunnery sergeant, so growing up in that family, he was 49 when I was born in 1969, so he was an older guy. If anybody's seen the movie Full Metal Jacket, Gunnery Sergeant Hartman, that's kind of a depiction of my father growing up. You had to do things immediately and fast and right, otherwise you get yelled at. So a couple of things on this. We've got the blue with the three boar's heads, which are depictions of the Gordons. The little cogwheels on the side, my dad was a civil engineer when this was granted to him, so there's obviously no real civil engineers. You can't really put that civil engineer, or he was a professional engineer as well, so you couldn't put PE. That doesn't make sense. So they thought back in the medieval time, who would be somebody that would be like an engineer? And they thought the cogwheels, trying to make things work, and the wheel and all that stuff. So the cogwheels represent his profession. As a Marine, that crest up there on the top is a wyvern, which is a mythical beast that doesn't exist in reality. A wyvern was supposed to be a beast that fought evil. So you think, he was in World War II, axis of evil. We're going to give you the idea of a creature that fights evil. And then the closed book, my dad always, he was loved knowledge, was an eminent reader and so forth. But he said that book represented the fact that, and bear with me, anybody who's a former Marine or Army officer or non-com or anything like that, that the deeds, a man never parades his achievements. So he said that was the book of deeds of all the things I've done that have been worthwhile in the world, but they're only for me to know. I don't have to show them to the world. So it's a twofold thing. One, he was a scholar and a reader, but also that's my book of deeds. I don't need to show anybody what I did. I know what I did inside. So they're recorded there, but I don't need to show anybody. And then the top, it says, Donec totum impliet orbem, which I mentioned before. Bidan was the coat of arms on the Gordon coat of arms for saying remaining faithful. That literally translates until the circle is complete. Loosely translated means loyalty until death. So there's an allusion there. It's not the exact motto, but it's a motto close enough. All right, we'll go next. Now, I mentioned artistic license. This is my coat of arms in Scotland. This is my coat of arms as it was matriculated in Spain. It's the exact same coat of arms, but you can see the artist that drew them a little differently. But if you read the blazon, which is the description of the arms, it's the same. So again, back to masonry. This is Florida masonry. That's Pennsylvania masonry. It's still masonry. It's still the exact same thing. It's still telling the same story, just in a slightly different way by the interpretation of those who are telling it. It still follows the same rules. They've moved the motto from the top to the bottom, because in Spain, all the coat of arms have mottos at the bottom. So it's just, this is a district deputy in Florida. This is a district deputy for you guys. It's just a little different, but it still represents the exact same things. It still represents all the traits and qualities that were originally granted to its holder. This is mine on one side, and you probably can't see it too well, but right here in the back, if you guys are in the back, you see that little label right there? That is the label showing that that's my son's coat of arms. So that differentiates between the two of us, one man, one coat of arms. It's a temporary label, so if I had a second son, there'd be a different symbol there, and that would stay with him for life. This one comes off on my death. My son then assumes these arms, and then his son will take that one. And if he had a grandson, or if I have a grandson, instead of a label of 3 points, it'll be a label of 5 points, and so on. So they have specific ways of depicting the birth order of sons. They also have it with daughters, but that's only come into fashion really recently. So again, symbols. This symbol has no intrinsic meaning other than what we've given it, which means you're my firstborn son. This symbol, if it were on there, means you're my ninthborn son. Sorry, ladies. But that would mean that I have 9 sons, but that in itself does not represent anything other than just what I've given meaning to. So again, in masonry, the things that we give meaning to, it's only because we give them meaning and we take on the idea that they have something to tell us. This is the way they do cadency, and I'll move through this super quick because I know we're running low on time, and also the fact that this is kind of difficult if you're not familiar with it. But you can see this top part is the original father. This is his firstborn son with that label. And that shows that every generation will always take that original coat of arms. It's unchanging throughout. The secondborn son in Scotland, they changed the border to gold. And it ends up coming down so that now that secondborn son, all his generations, that's how the coat of arms will look. This person over here had another son, so they changed it with wavy lines. this person, they put this. So depending on how far you go down the chart, they even have one over here because I guess in Scotland we had a lot of illegitimate children. So if you ever see somebody with a thing like that in Scotland, it probably means at some point you come from an illegitimate line. But there's ways to depict who you are in your family tree through the way your coat of arms is designed. I bring this up only for those of you that are members of St. Thomas of Aquin. Please don't go back and say this is what's happening. This is a proposal that we proposed last year to the Grand Master, and now the current Grand Master is taken under advisement. This was a proposal from the American College of Heraldry of how to differentiate the different provinces as well as the different chapels that come throughout the state. And you can see, this is the original one, which has, it's the cross, it's got a little shell there, the little pilgrim shell, and then it's got our thing called the glory, which if you look on the one of our bills, it has that presidential seal type thing. And that depicts our national arms, which is the Grand Master's Council. The provinces would all have silver shells, but would have something different. Now, these are just examples here. And then the chapels, local chapels, would have a red shell with a cross and then something different to differentiate them. And I've actually got, this is the Southeast Province. This was just actually approved and made through the American College of Heraldry. It was approved by the Grand Master. So if you see this, you know that you were in the Southeast. And that we just depicted, hey, the sun is always shining somewhere in hot Florida, Georgia, Tennessee, Alabama, all those places. So that depicts us. Someplace for you guys, I don't know what would be depicted in Pennsylvania. I think you have your own province, if I'm not mistaken. But that would, you'd find some symbol that would depict, it could be, the Keystone, thank you, yes, Keystone. That would be there. This is our local chapel that I belong to, Crusader Chapel. So we have the Crusader's Cross over here, the Cross of Jerusalem. And that's a way to depict us. So now we have banners and so forth that we use when we go to our meetings. Other companies, organizations, I happen to be a member of the Worshipful Company of Fletchers outside of London. This is their coat of arms. And again, they have the various symbols. Fletchers obviously make arrows. So we've got the three arrows there between the chevron. This is the actual Worshipful Company of Masons, not Freemasons, but the Worshipful Company of Masons that are stonemasons in England. And you can see they've got buildings there, and they've got the square, they've just got the compass and so forth. But keep attracted to that, because this is the original coat of arms of the United Grand Lodge of Masons of England, the moderns. If you can see, that looks just like this coat of arms here, right? I mean, remember, artistic license, the shield may look different, but everything on there, the three buildings, the chevron, the square, it's all there. So they kind of usurped it a little bit, if you really look at that. They usurped it. This is for the ancients. Now, if we look at the ancients, and we go back and look at the moderns, now look at what the actual United Grand Lodge of England, they marshaled them, they put them together. So this is the original one from the moderns, this is from the ancients. So that's their coat of arms that they have. It shows a marriage between the two. This one is the Worshipful Company of Masons, side by side. So you can see the original scheme of how they sort of, if we believe our legends, came out of the stonemasons, they'd be there. This is Scotland, so they sort of took it and They put the Scottish Psalter over on this side, but this, other than the color change, looks just like the original coat of arms. And you can see just two different coats of arms depicted by different heraldic artists. This is from New Zealand. This is their coat of arms. Again, they focused on that original coat of arms, but then they've got the Southern Cross, which you look up in the night sky. If you're down in the South area, South Pacific, you'd see that. They've got their little kiwi over to the side. On the crest, they have the square and compasses with the all-seeing eye. These are provincial lodges. Again, you can see how they've sort of made their own, but yet they've kept the original over here, but then this sort of changes a little bit, or they change something up here. They change the border going around it. Again, same type of things. They all look very similar, but they've changed borders, so it shows East Lancaster, West Wales. This is Edinburgh, Scotland number one there, and this is my lodge Endeavour. I belong to a lodge in Australia. That's their lodge. These are the two that I wanted to show you, Matt Dupay and Glenn Cook. You can see, a Scottish coat of arms on this side with Glenn Cook. This is his arms. The Matt Dupay, these are English coat of arms. You'll see something below Matt's, which is kind of interesting. This is actually an old coat of arms. You'll see that little Maltese cross. He's a member of the order, the Venerable Order of St. John, which is not the Masonic order. It's actually the order from the King of, now the King of England. And so he was awarded, this is showing him as a commander. He's actually been made a full knight, so his looks a little different. This, Glenn Cook is the same. He's also a commander, but you can see he doesn't depict his arms with that. This is a member of the Venerable Order of St. John. I don't know who it is. I forgot who. My friend gave me this and said, use it. This shows an actual Maltese cross behind it. His shield is superimposed on it. And then he's got the big black collar going around it, which shows he's a full knight of the order. So in essence, Glenn Cook could put his arms on that Maltese cross and have that big symbol showing that. Coats of arms often are depicted in banneral form or different types. You can see this is actually Garter Chapel. So the Knights of the Order of the Garter, those are chapel stalls right there that you'd sit in for church services. They have their banners on top, and this is their on top of their stalls. They have a depiction of their crest. Those come down when they die, and on the back side of those chairs, there's a whole history of who's ever sat in that chair when they die. They take a nice little bronze plaque, and they engrave their coat of arms, put their name, and put it on the back. So if you start out at the bottom, and you work your way up because the people ahead of you have passed away, at some point you will pass away too. Wherever you passed away, that's where they put the depiction of your arms so they know you sat there as a member of the Order of the Garter. These are my flags, my son's flags on the right, my flags on the left. They're just little desk flags. I use those when I go to different formal events, especially heraldic events. So when I sit at my table, instead of putting a place card with my name, I put my little flag so I know it. And when there's all these flags going around, we're trying to get that in our chapel for the Order of St. Thomas, because it's kind of a cool way to depict in the statues of St. Thomas. It says if you have a coat of arms, you can have a little flag behind your station, and as well as during dinner and so forth. So we try to do all that good stuff. Now, I've given a little bibliography here, but I did say that before I wrap it up, I did say that I want to. I haven't vanished yet. That's amazing. My partner has not made me vanish, so I'm really cool about that. I must not be that boring, at least to you. You guys have an interesting banner here, which we would say doesn't follow the traditional rules of heraldry by any means, but if you took it out and put it onto a shield, it would actually have that chevron in the back. I don't know what that chevron means. Maybe it's depicted as the square that we know in masonry, but maybe not. You've got the two, what are those called? I'm trying to think. My wife would call them esconces to put stuff, but they're torches. I'm assuming that's the quasi-lamp of knowledge, right? And then you have what's the familiar symbol, which would be a shield within a shield, the escutcheon, or an escutcheon, the Masonic symbol, and a motto up on top. So that technically could be turned into a coat of arms that you would have depicted on letterhead if you didn't want to represent it as the round seal that you're probably so familiar using. So a lot of the things that we see in masonry are trying to tell us something. Again, those are just flames. They don't mean anything of themselves, but am I correct in saying they're the lamp of knowledge, the light of knowledge or something? So for us, they have meaning. So when you look at a coat of arms, and I'll end it by this, when you look at a coat of arms, it has meaning. It may not have any meaning to you other than the ladies going, wow, that's a pretty coat of arms. Those lions look really fierce. That unicorn is so pretty. But the reality is it had meaning at some point to the person who they were assigned to. It really represented that person, his life's achievements, something about him, the great things he did, maybe some of the bad things he did. And it allows that family to have a structure of continuance throughout from that original person through various generations. Just like we as Masons had that continuance. You've got the statue out there of George Washington. We all know George Washington, Ben Franklin, name some Masons. All those symbols that we revere as Masons also make us think of those people. And when we think of those people, how many times in various rituals do you say, you know, to make you a forsworn man and Mason if you break this promise? It's because they're saying, these guys were great. You need to act like them. We revere them. And so with that, I will close. Thank you very much. I'm sorry you didn't have any questions. I hope you have questions at the end. It was definitely a pleasure speaking before the Pennsylvania Academy of Masonic Knowledge. Thank you so much.
It is now 10:30. We'll take a 15-minute break. Please return by 10:45, and we'll introduce our next speaker.
He's going to magically appear on stage. We're not going to introduce him.
Where's the trap door?
Did I go too long?
You were right.
Okay.
right, everybody, come on back in and have a seat. We will keep moving with the program. We will have time for Q&A after lunch today, so we'll make sure we get a chance to chat with our presenters. As we get settled, I'd like to take a moment to recognize the team here at the Masonic Villages, both the residents and the staff who work to make this event possible, run the live stream, and take care of this room and the food for us. Would you please show them your appreciation? Thank you. After our second presenter, we will break for lunch. Lunch is downstairs in the Brossman Ballroom. It's a free will offering for lunch to cover the cost of the program. So go down the steps outside, kind of down around the corner, follow the herd. You'll find your way to lunch. And then we will come back up here generally about 1 o'clock. We'll make that call here in a few minutes. On to our second presenter. It is my pleasure to introduce to you Brother Ralph Shelton. A lifelong magician, he is a member of the legendary Long Beach Mystics, as well as the International Brotherhood of Magicians, the Society of American Magicians, and the Invisible Lodge International. He retired from a successful career as a professional magician in the corporate and resort markets to study law. He is a member of and regular performer at the world-famous Magic Castle in Hollywood, California, where he has served on the board of directors. His 35-year law career has been as a litigator and expert in governance of nonprofit and mutual benefit organizations. He's a frequent lecturer and mentor in the legal field and is a senior partner of Schiff and Shelton, a boutique law firm in Newport Beach, California. An active Freemason and student of Masonic philosophy and Masonic law, he has founded 2 lodges, including California's first affinity lodge, the Old Cup and Ball Lodge No. 880, a lodge of magician Freemasons. He supports Masonic philanthropy and is a trustee of the California Masonic Foundation, which oversees their Masonic villages, and he has been very impressed with our facility here this weekend. And he also serves as vice president and general counsel of the California Scottish Rite Foundation. He's a past master of Orange Grove Lodge, No. 293, and recently served as the grand chaplain of the Grand Lodge of California. I now invite Brother Shelton to take the stage and begin his presentation entitled Magic and Affinity in Masonry, if you would welcome him.
Am I on up here yet? Thank you very much, Seth. I appreciate that. Welcome back from the break, and I know that I'm the only thing between you and lunch, so I'm going to try to be very interesting. Just to wake you all up, my name's Ralph Shelton. Show of hands, how many already knew that? Okay, I was introduced about 10 seconds ago, so you should know by now. You guys in the back, Brett and I were talking about this. Pay attention. Airy was, in a word, a fooler. He could make you believe just about anything. He claimed to be born in Appleton, Wisconsin, and people believed it. But he was born in Budapest, Hungary. He settled in Appleton with his family when they emigrated to America. Appleton wasn't a successful landing spot for them, and not long later, when he was about 13 years old, they moved to glamorous New York City. Airy worked odd jobs. He performed on the streets. He did juggling, tightrope, and he learned that he could fool people better than most, and he could make money doing it. While he was performing, he met... Sorry, there's an extra slide in there. I keep clicking this thing, and it's not going. There we go. He met Wilhelmina. The two fell in love. They married, and they set their sights on Europe for their success. Before they set off for Europe, they realized if they were going to go there and make their fortune, they'd have to do it under fake names, false identities. So Airy and Wilhelmina traveled to Europe, where they did quite well. They fleeced the masses. They returned to the United States in triumph. And ironically, once they were back in the United States, Airy the fooler, the trickster, he took on the scam artists of the day here in the United States. The fake spiritual mediums. the people who claimed to be able to communicate with those who had passed over to the other world. He exposed them for the frauds they were, and his fame grew even greater. Eri, the guy I'm talking about, well, Eri was a nickname. It was the Hungarian nickname for Eric. It was mispronounced in America as Harry. His fake last name, that's one you all already know, because Eric Weiss had reinvented himself as Harry Houdini. Now, Brother Houdini was raised in St. Cecile Lodge, number 568 in New York City. He joined not only the Blue Lodge, but also the Scottish Rite, where he gave benefit performances for the Valley of New York. He joined the Shrine later on. We'll cover that in a moment. I, by the way, ran across his application for Shrine, and I found it to be extremely entertaining. If you look closely, he was lying about where he was from. He said Appleton, Wisconsin, but he listed himself as author, lecturer, and mystifier. Now, when he passed away, at his funeral, he had the broken wand ceremony of the Society of American Magicians, but more importantly, he had a traditional Masonic service. Now, a lot's been written about Harry Houdini. He wasn't the only great magician of his age, obviously. He's the one that's most remembered today, but he certainly wasn't the best of the time. He did share, however, his Masonic ties with a lot of other guys, a lot of other great magicians of the era. What he never did was wear the mantle of magic. What is the mantle of magic, you wonder? Well, it's a recognition of the epitome of the magicians of the day, the great American magician from our professional world. It relates to masonry because all the wearers of this symbolic cape have, with one exception, been among our Masonic brethren. First in line was Harry Keller. He was presented the mantle of magic, and this guy was huge. When his show rolled into town, it was like having Beyonce, U2, and the Stones all on the stage at the same time. Everybody went. He brought the floating lady, or the levitation of Princess Karnak, to the stage, and he lived at his estate in Los Angeles, which is typically miscalled the Houdini Estate, because the lesser-known Harry owned it, while the more famous Harry spent a lot of time visiting and hanging out on the property that Keller owned across the street. The two became very, very good friends, and long after Keller had retired, not long before his death, the younger Harry brought him back for one last show, a benefit for the families of those who were killed when the USS Antilles was sunk by a German U-boat. Keller took the craft very seriously, and he always traveled with his Masonic patent. Once Brother Keller was shipwrecked in the Bay of Biscay, and his belongings went to the bottom of the sea. His luggage was later recovered by divers, and it included his Masonic patent. After that, when he traveled, when he showed it to someone, they would see the stains, and he would explain, well, this has been viewed by the Grand Master Neptune, approved and returned. Side note, Keller was always rather envious of Alexander Herman. Herman was actually a much better performer, and he often played the same cities as Keller. The rivalry became so intense that Keller even would have his people show up and paper over Herman's competing advertisements. Today, that might have resulted in Masonic charges because, as you might suspect by now, Herman was also a Master Mason. Anyway, when it was time to pass the mantle of magic, Keller passed it, as you can see on the left, to Howard Thurston. Brother Howard Thurston of Mantu Lodge, New York City. Thurston gave him his magic wand, the mantle of magic, and Thurston proceeded to really own the stages. He was very famous in his day, touring constantly, and so often he found himself in a city which he hadn't played before. When he would do that, he was known to toss in a little bit of Masonic code. He would get up on stage, and at some point in his show, he tended to say something along the lines of, "Now with the magic word, Hiram Abiff, see what happens." And after the show, he would meet all the locals. He said it was very special to be able to meet the best of the community when he was in town. He said, "I sometimes think that traveling Masons have more opportunities of being both proud and glad of the social distinction designated by the square and compasses than those who remain home most of the time. What a wonderful thing it is for a stranger to be able to meet the best men of the community on their arrival through that brotherhood. Now, when it's time for him to retire, he needed to pass the mantle on to someone worthy. A hot debate broke out among American magicians. Would it go to this guy, Boughton, Harry Boughton, also known as Blackstone Sr., or on the right, you have Jansen, who we now know as Dante. Now, they had certain similarities. Their shows weren't that different. They kind of had the same mode of dress and the same intense stare and facial hair. So it was a tough decision. Oh, yeah, they were also both Master Masons. Ultimately, it ended up being Dante who was selected to wear the mantle, and he actually became the more successful of the magicians, although today, again, not necessarily the best remembered. He traveled the world as the world-famous bearer of the mantle of magic. He even appeared in some Hollywood films. You'll see him over here with another well-known Master Mason on the left there, Oliver Hardy. And then there came a time when he needed to pass it on. So he passed it on to a guy you've probably never heard of, a guy named Lee Grable. Lee was a member of Danville Lodge. 1954, he claimed the mantle. And he was one of the last great touring shows of the 1940s and 1950s. He was big. He met and married a wonderful woman named Helene just before he shipped out for World War II. And when he got back, he said, well, now it's time to tour. Helene said, you know, I'm really not that interested in being a magician's assistant. Lee said, not a problem. I'm going to find a pretty young gal. I'm going to take her on the road with me. We'll see you in a year. Helene said, you know what? I think maybe I want to be a part of your act. Helene was a piano player, and they sat down and figured out their new signature piece. It was the floating piano. Helene would play the piano on stage, and while she did, she would take requests from the audience. Lee would then float her in the air through a hoop. I don't know how she did that upside down. I can't play the piano vertically, but somehow she did. They were well known, as I said, stage performers. However, television came into the picture, and it pretty well killed the stage performers of the day. Just that whole process just kind of died out. So Lee, he'd settled in Alamo, California. He found a new career as a real estate broker and investor, and he held on to that mantle for almost 40 years, looking for a worthy successor. He finally found one in a guy named Lance Burton. Lance is recently retired. Even he, though the first one not to be a Master Mason to bear the mantle, he has his Masonic ties. He's known for doing benefit performances for Shrine Hospitals. I've had him at a couple of benefit events. His closest buddy is also a Master Mason. Keeps leaning on him a little bit, but making sure it's still of his own free will and accord. In 2010, he was presented the Nevada Outstanding Citizen Award by the Grand Lodge of Nevada. And like I said, he's around that many Masons. There's still hope for this guy. Now, beyond this dynasty, of course, there were many other famous magicians who are our brothers, such as Chung Ling Su, Theo Bamberg, known as Okito, Carter the Great, John Calvert. I had the honor of performing his Masonic ceremony. He was just over 100 years old when he passed. In fact, he did his 100th birthday by performing in Los Angeles and then flying to New York to do his full stage show at 100 years old. I'd be lucky if I could do that today. Carl Ballantyne, this guy basically created comedy magic. That list goes on. So that leaves us to ask, what is it that attracts magicians to masonry and masons to magic? Oh, I left one out, by the way. I wanted to mention this guy. That's Cardini. Pitchford's his real name. He actually learned how to manipulate cards during World War I when he served in the trenches. He wore his gloves all the time because of the weather conditions, and he learned to manipulate the cards with his gloves on and balls and other objects. Later, after the war, he took the gloves off. He went out to perform and realized he couldn't do it without the gloves on. So he became famous for being this guy who could do these fantastic manipulations with cigarettes and balls and cards with gloves on. No other magician could do it. He said, well, I can't do it any other way. Anyways, the question I was posing was, what attracts magicians and masons to one another. And some suggest that it's the secrets. Well, it could be that, but I think there's more to it. Masons see the world differently than other men, and magicians do as well. Masons are independent, critical thinkers, and no one thinks more critically than a magician. They see through the illusion and the trickery, and they question appearances, just like Masons. When you see a coin vanish, a magician sees the coin stolen away. And when a layperson sees an imperfect soul, a Mason sees a rough ashlar that yearns to be honed to perfection, or to dent your stage, I gather from last year. Magicians and Masons differ from the world, but they're very much alike in their quest for perfection. Their strong bonds of friendship, their tolerance, their inclusivity, and both in their way make the world a better place. Now, magicians have a special spot in Hollywood, California, the Magic Castle, home to the Academy of Magical Arts. You'll find it nestled in the hills above Hollywood Boulevard. Down the stairs, if you're there, you go to the Inner Circle. And when you get to the Inner Circle, there's a very special presentation there. That is an homage to the greats of magic. There are two empty spots that have now been filled in this photograph. You'll see one of them added in. It's one of my favorite spots because when I'm there with other people, I like to point this out. I say, can you look up there and find the Master Mason among the group? And most of the time somebody will say Houdini. By the way, I especially love to do this when I'm with a Grand Master at the Magic Castle because it keeps them in their place. Look up there, they'll say Houdini. What? But my last Grand Master, the one I served as Grand Chaplain, he's a member of my Magician's Lodge. He's a magician. He's a hilarious guy, by the way. He didn't know. He thought it was Thurston, and I pointed out, nope, it's all of them. The exquisite sculptures depict Harry Keller, Howard Thurston, Chung Ling Su, Harry Houdini, Robert Houdin, Alexander Herman, Dante, and Cardini. They're not all wearers of the mantle, but they are all connected by their craft. Not just by the craft of magic, but as I said, the craft we all share. Each and every man who's been chosen for the unique honor to be included among the greats of magic is your brother Mason, who rose to the ranks of both crafts. Not to be better than everyone else, but to do what Masons do, to do what magicians do. The commonality between the two being, we don't try to be better than everybody else. We just try every day to be the best that we can be. Now, got to find my place here. There we go. There's another gathering of Master Masons. It's a study in how Masons can share more than just the fun of magic. And that lives on in today's First Affinity Lodge in California, which is the Cup and Ball Lodge number 880. Recently, there was a piece done about us, and it resulted in this video that I'd like to share. The piece that was done was in our California Freemason magazine. Now, some copies were out there, and I know a lot of folks picked them up. There wasn't one for everybody here present today. So those of you who are just going to take that and drop it off, and some of you will, find somebody that really wants one and give them a copy. Our junior past grandmaster, as I mentioned, Randy Brill, you'll find him inside. He's a member of the Cup and Ball Lodge. There's a caricature of him there on the right. And the next guy you might recognize as well, that's me peeking out from behind a curtain 40 pounds ago. The center spread was the executive committee of the Cup and Ball Lodge. You'll find Dave Benitez, me, Rob Peppel, then John Dilly, and on the end there, Sean Fernald. That's the Master Two Warden, Secretary, and Treasurer. I found that that treasurer spot to be the perfect one for me because I really don't have to do that much because it's a small, tiny lodge. But again, this is an affinity lodge model, not as popular in the United States as you'll find in Europe. Let me show you a little video about Cup and Ball Lodge.
Hello, my friends. My name is David Benitez, and I am a member of the old Cup and Ball Lodge number 880, right here at the Magic Castle in Hollywood, California.
Now, you know, a few years ago, I got a call from someone who said, in Europe they have the concept of the Affinity Lodge, which is a double level of bonding. Masons who share another interest of some kind. It could be one of many things. And we just really don't have that in California. We've never tried it. So the idea sparked that, well, we knew there were a lot of magicians who are Masons, and we knew that we already had a club, so let's try an Affinity Lodge. And from that, Cup and Ball was born.
For many years, I've been coming to the castle with my brother as part of the family of magic and magicians, and then to see masonry kind of come into that same scene has always been something that I've noticed when I was growing up. I saw a lot of Masons around the castle, and I was able to get excited about the idea that, hey, there's something else going on here, and I didn't quite know what it was. And now, being that I've been through the journey of masonry, and to be able to have our meetings in the castle and just share that special place, I kind of look at this as a home away from home.
Growing up, I idolized Harry Houdini and was tickled when I found out that Eric Weiss, a.k.a. Harry Houdini, was also a Freemason.
There are so few masonry jokes, it's literally not even funny. When you're the magician and you go out with your friends, you're what I like to call the entertainment monkey. So when magicians go out, we bring a balloon guy.
And you know, I can't imagine why.
I mean, really, we have just as much respect as the rest of the guys in the Magic Castle. And frankly, when we're done with a trick, at least people know when we're done.
I invite all non-Masons to become a Mason, and all Masons to become a magician. And I prepare a little show for you.
So I think what the biggest challenge of Cup and Ball has been is that magicians are naturally, you know, eclectic people. And I'm proud to say that we've done an excellent job over the course of the, what I call our dispensation, and over the course of being constituted, of really trying to make sure that we show up for Grand Lodge and demonstrate that this experiment can be done properly when you have a focus of a lodge that's not purely on just masonry.
Every member of this lodge genuinely enjoys being in the company of every other member. I've seen more engagement, I've seen more interaction, and I've seen more genuine happiness to get together here than I've ever seen in another group of Masons.
I love that little puff of smoke at the end. It kind of made the video for me. So that video made the rounds of the repeatedly, what is an Affinity Lodge? What's it about? What's it for? Well, Affinity Lodge is different than a typical craft lodge. And about half of the Masons, for example, in Europe are master Masons who join a craft lodge, and they work their way over to become a member of...
Go ahead.
Okay. All right. That was fun to watch.
Yeah, just the magic. This mic is on if you want to... You can't walk and talk.
Is that one on? Is that I can't walk and talk? Okay, show of hands. You want me to walk and talk, or do you want me to get on that mic? Walk and talk? Okay, there's show of voices too. Get on that mic. Walk and talk, wait. Yes, thank you. You can tell I've been a professional entertainer and an attorney for many years, because I could talk to the back of that room. It started when I was a DMLA, and it really hasn't gotten any quieter since. That question came up, and our Grand Secretary's office called me up and said, hey, we know there's a club of magicians. Let's try something new with this Affinity Lodge. Okay, well, let's give it a shot. We looked into it. Did some study. And I wanted to know, what is an Affinity Lodge? What makes it? I have more slides. Just so you know. Okay, thank you.
this one on, and I'm not going to yell anymore. There you go. Can you hear me? Are we good? Those of you who didn't say yeah, can you hear me? All right, good. All right. All right, let's just start over. My name is Ralph. How many of you already? Harry, who did? Yeah, anyway. But it is a wonderful thing. I've heard some objections to it where people say that could detract from the Blue Lodges. Actually, no, it enhances the Blue Lodge experience. Also, it promotes tremendous engagement, and it gets Masons more interested in their Masonry at the Craft Lodge. The primary purpose of a Craft Lodge is to create Masons, to make Masons. A secondary purpose of that Craft Lodge is to provide continuing Masonic education through fraternal interaction and Masonic education, right? Straight up Masonic education. Now, an affinity lodge. Okay, now we're not doing this. Okay, there we go. There we go. There we go. Okay. An affinity lodge, primary purpose, provide continuing Masonic growth and education through social interaction of guys with a common interest. Secondary purpose, make Masons. So they really have different reasons. In Europe, you'll find some great lodges. They're straight up professional lodges, lawyer lodges, cop lodges, doctor lodges, some weird ones. There's a science fiction and fantasy lodge. There's some karate lodges. Here in the United States, a few Grand Lodges have affinity lodges. We have the Magicians in California. I believe it's Kansas that has the Law Enforcement Lodge. They're not in every jurisdiction, but think about that sometime. Think about this. If your lodge has 300 members, your typical meeting or event will have 30 to 50 members show up, so 10% or a little bit more. If your lodge has 100 members, your typical event will have 30 to 50 members show up, typically on the low end, about 30% engagement. If you have an affinity lodge, the model calls for the following. Number one, you share a meeting space. You don't have to own a building and be tied to it. Number two, you meet on a quarterly basis, but you interact in between. Number three, and most importantly, every member comes to every meeting and every event. 100% engagement. So if you have a lodge of 30 to 50 members in your affinity lodge, your second lodge, you have 100% engagement. If the guys in your 300-member lodge break down into also 10 affinity lodges, you now have 100% engaged Masonry. And that's a strong Masonry, and that has a certain magical feel to it. Because again, you've got guys with one interest, guys with another interest, and right there where those two intersect, that is the sweet spot. That's one that I keep up on my wall to remind me of why we have the Cup and Ball Lodge. It was proof of concept when we did Cup and Ball. It showed how successful an affinity lodge can be, and just last week, we instituted two more affinity lodges. We instituted the Wayfarers Lodge. That's a group of outdoor enthusiasts, campers. We also instituted the 33 Royal Lodge. That's a group of Disney enthusiasts. It's California. We've got more than our share. It put a Mickey Mouse on it. Believe me, people will come. On the decks, we now have a couple of other ones coming up. Wine Lovers. We have an RV group. This one's an off-road RV group. We have Boat Lovers coming along. And I'm surprised we haven't had Woodworkers yet, but I'm pretty sure you guys in Pennsylvania might be forming one pretty soon. There's at least a dozen of you here today. I'm looking forward to a quilting lodge, because that was actually, no, I'm not. But today, we're going to try something a little different because I would like to demonstrate in a visceral manner how this breaks down. All right? Brett, would you give me a hand? You can stay right there and do it. I'm going to give you a book. We're going to create a little tiny affinity lodge right now. This is my favorite book, War of the Worlds, H.G. Wells. Would you just go out there and hand it to some people? Just randomly pick one. He's walking. Give him that one. He's walking down the aisle. That's what you get for standing up there. I want you to flip that book open to any page. Look at the last word on the page. The last word on the page. It'll be in the lower right. Okay? You got one? Good. Give the book back to Brett. Remain standing. Brett, hand it five more people. So there you go, brother. Take a look at that. Stand up. Turn to any page. Look at the last word on the page. Memorize that word. Got it? There you go. Stay standing. That's okay. Well, pass it on to him. That's fine. That's fair. Stand up. Apparently, you didn't get the hint. I'll fill you in. Stand up there. Open the book, any page. Look at the last word on the page. Memorize that word. Got one? Give it back to Brett. Stay standing. Brett, give me a few more. Three more people. I decided it was important for me to have a cute assistant when going on the road. I brought Brett. Got one, brother? All right, good. You got your word. Last word on any page. Oh, there we go. One of our lovely ladies in attendance. Please open the book to any page. Last word on the page. You got one? All right. And one more. This guy says, not me, not me, not me. Yes, you're stuck now. Got one? Last word on a page, right? You memorized it? All right. That's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's enough. All right. Thank you, Brett. Appreciate that. I'll take the book back. You can go resume your seat. Thank you. You've already done your work for the day. Now, focus on the word that you thought of. I'm focusing on some words. I'm focusing on some feelings. I'm getting an impression that I'm laying down. I'm laying in a field. I'm looking up. I'm very relaxed at this point. I'm seeing formations in the sky. One of them is in the shape of a flower. It's warm where I am. No, it's not warm where I am. It's hot where I am. I think I know. I'm going to put these all together. I'm coming up with words. I've got sky. Cloud, dream, earth, fire, and grass. The six of you who are standing, if I named the word that you thought of in that book, please join me on stage. Six for six, ladies and gentlemen. Please stand right up here. Why don't we start with you on the end here? You folks come on over. Just stand next to each other. Make a nice, neat line. Come on this way. Yeah, he's on the far end. Come on. And I got number three. Stand right here. There we go. Let's move everyone this way. Okay, you know what? I'm going to move the stool. It's just easier. Okay, there we go. There we go. Welcome to the Psychic Game Show, ladies and gentlemen. Now, I would ask your names, but I'm just terrible with names. So instead, actually, it's off stage. I'm going to have you just take one of these name tags. Take that. I want to write your name on there. Not your name. Write any fake name. Because I might know your name. I might know who you are. This wouldn't make it a great trick, would it be? Yeah, well, okay, I'm going to get you. Take one. You take one. You take one. You take one. You take one. It's a repetitive part of the show. He's going to write down a name, pass that pen down. It's a fake name. It could be someone you admire. It could be a name you find entertaining. It could be, I don't know, somebody you want to be when you grow up. I don't know what I'm going to do when I grow up, so you probably don't either. Pass that on down. I really didn't think this part through. I should have had more pens. Great, okay, I got one more. Now, just start passing your cards to anyone. You'll be the collector. You collect the name badges, okay? So, hand those down to him, and you're going to mix them up for me, if you would. Turn them face down, mix those up so I can't know which one was written by whom. Do you still have my pen down there? Good, I lose way too many of these. These aren't cheap. No, hang on, go stand over there. Resume your place. Okay, got it? All right, now. In fact, you know what? Just give me the top one instead of all. Oh God, there we go. Instead of all, just the top one. So these are mixed. I have a name badge. It says Joe. I saw this group up here, Joe. Joe is just a real normal name, just an average guy. G.I. Joe. We've all heard Joe in so many contexts. Eat a Joe. You look like a Joe, am I right? All right. Give me another one. There we go. So this one, okay, this is interesting. This one says Harry. We just talked about Houdini. I'm guessing that's where this one comes from. Let me see. You look like a Harry. Are you a Harry? Am I right? Give me another one. Awesome. Okay. Robert. Robert. You're a Robert. Am I right?
Yep.
Got that one. Give me another one. Okay, I'm doing okay. I'm halfway there. All right? But right now, it's about an even money flip. Let me take this one off. These stickers are maddening. Now, that one says Fred. When I see Fred, I think Flintstone. Yep, and I'm thinking, this is my Yabba Dabba Doo guy right here. One more there. Now, hold on to that last one, and that's important. Okay. Huh. Now, I'm going to guess. This is probably sexist. This one says Chrissy. I think you might have made that a little easy on me, so here you go, Chrissy. Now, I don't even know what's on that car, and I already know it's yours. But now I've got to figure this out. I've got to look at you. That is clearly a guy who has taken his Masonic teachings seriously, and I'm thinking, reached down into those for today's purpose. Someone he aspired to be. I don't know if it's the one from Tyre or it's the widow's son who did all the heavy crafting, but I think you wrote down Hiram, am I right? Yeah, that's 6 for 6. Oh, yes, he did. Good. Real good job. Now, because we're Masons and stuff, we all wear these name badges all the time. Now they all have those. By the way, if it was me, it says, hello, my name is. I usually write Inigo Montoya, but nobody ever gets that. I'm going to make a prediction. Yeah. Because, again, it's a psychic game show. Now we're going to play. There's going to be some winner. There's going to be a winner. Probably going to be some losers. I have some steps here. We got a few decisions to make. Fortunately, they're all pre-written on the cards, and our contestants get to be the ones who make all of the choices. But I want to point something out. We have all the Masons that are in this state at this time. Today, we've got a little more than a couple of hundred of them that are in this room, right? So that's the commonality. And as I mentioned, we have the woodworkers thing. Well, these six people have a very special connection. If they run into each other, if any of you runs into each other somewhere else, say, hey, I met you at the symposium. These six people will have that extra level of connection. They may not look forward to seeing one another, I don't know. But they'll bump into one another at an event and they'll say, yeah, you got dragged up on stage by that crazy guy. And they'll share that. And that's that level of connection that is so important in the concept of an affinity lodge. So, we're creating Psychic Game Show Affinity Lodge number 1. First step says, any 3 people, by the way, I have them marked, step 1. Any 3 people step forward. So you all work that out among yourselves. 3 of you step forward, 3 of you stand back. Okie dokie. Now we have step 2. This is interesting. If you didn't step forward, sorry, you are out of the game. So you 3 in the back, thank you for joining us. Please return to your seats, and let's send them back with a round of applause. But there's more. It says, of the remaining 3, 2 of you raise your right hand. So work that out among yourselves, and I'll move on to step 3. Okay, all right. Harry over there is giving all the shots. Oh, this is even better. Wait, so it was you and you. I want to make sure I have the right people before I reveal this all-important step. Step 3. If you didn't raise your hand, Harry, Congratulations, you're the winner. Is that right there? So let's send these two gentlemen, apparently our wardens of the Psychic Game Show Lodge, back to their seats with a round of applause. Now, Harry, congratulations. You're the winner of the Psychic Game Show. I want you to think of your prize. I want you to think of something cuddly, an animal perhaps. You got something in mind? You do? Okay. What's your animal?
Owl.
An owl. In a recent survey, 100 people were asked to name a cuddly animal that they would like to have in their home. 95 of those people said puppy. The other 5 people said teddy bear. Nobody said owl. But you know, Harry, it's a good thing you did, because there's your gift. You win a lovely, cuddly owl. Thank you very much. Head back with a big round of applause from Psychic Game Show Affinity Lodge number 1. That's a little bit of fun. You can see why magicians like hanging out with each other. What we do is a lot of fun. It's not everybody's jam. Neither is woodworking, neither is off-roading, neither is camping, neither is Disney. But when you can bring a group of people together who share that extra special bond, they're masons, they're the people we want to be around anyway, but then they're the people who also enjoy cooking or painting. We have a writer's workshop group that is becoming an affinity lodge. They get together every 3 months. They all show up. They have 100% engagement. That is a strong masonry, a vibrant masonry. In many cases, it's not everyone's flavor, but it can be the future of masonry. And if you ask me, that's actually truly very magical. Thank you all very much. It's been a pleasure.
At this time, I'd like to call on Brother Scott Mueller, Pastor's Deputy Grand Master and member of the committee, who's going to offer the lunch prayer for us. If you would rise and join us in prayer, and then you'll be dismissed down for lunch. Again, we will come back at 1 o'clock for questions and answers, so please be back here by 1 p.m., and Scott's going to cover our lunch prayer.
Great Architect of the Universe, be with us on our travels of the day. Bless all those who are here. Bless the staff of the Masonic Villages. Bless our meal preparers. And everybody be safe today. Amen.
So would it be. Thanks, sir. All right, we'll see you at 1 o'clock. Enjoy your lunch.
Chuck, Chuck. Chuck, Chuck. Chuck, Chuck. Thank you. Chuck, check. Mic check. Thank you.
She was going to take a picture of me speaking, but could not get me over because there was no stool for me to stand on. Let me know when you're done. I'll put it back. To the left of it, but you pointed to the right. Okay, stage right. You want me to go where? Here? Where? All the way. Wait, my whole fat body? All right. Now I can put this back up so the normal people can use it. See? No lines, no threads.
everybody. Good afternoon again. Welcome back. We hope that you enjoyed your lunch. If you did, please show your appreciation from the Sonic Village staff. Thank you, staff, for all your hard work today on lunch and making sure we're well-fed and managed. Our speakers are going to come up here and take the stage. Come on up, gentlemen. We're going to do about a half an hour of Q&A. We do have some questions coming in online as well. For those of you tuning in on the live stream, we do appreciate your questions. Just a reminder, the purpose of the Q&A is to ask questions of our presenters. While we very much appreciate your Masonic knowledge, we're here for theirs. So please keep your rebuttals and statements to a minimum and limit yourself to questions specifically for our presenters. So if you would like to interact and engage, raise your hand. One of our committee members will come around with a microphone. Who wants to be first up? There he goes, right in the middle. Let's see, where's Scott? We're going to make Scott run up there and do some work. And when you speak, if you would state your name and lodge number if you are a Mason. So repeat the question, just because I know it's a little light. If he's looking to get into the more esoteric side of Freemasonry, looking for some advice on where to look and learn more about that.
I would start with Brett. Oh.
And just before I begin, I know one of the brothers out there gave both of us these Mr. Jameson's balls, the
Scotch-filled
whiskey soak balls. Thank you.
It's gonna
I'm
make
slurring
your,
my words.
It's going to make your that. Q&A a lot more entertaining.
The whiskey-based candy is helpful for this. So esoteric.
Esoteric. So, I mean, I don't think either one of our talks was on the esoteric aspects of Freemasonry, but I enjoy it a lot. And I know one of the first groups that I joined was the Philalethes Society because they had papers that went so in-depth that I felt like, yeah, that's a B-17 going over my head. It's so high above me, I don't know what's going on. But then they have, you've got the California Research, Lodge of Research. There's all these societies now, AMD, that have just a plethora of papers and research that get into the esoteric areas. So I really could not point you to one direct thing, but I'd definitely say start off with the Philalethes Society. They're really great. And any of Lodge of Research from any of the states that are open. Yeah.
Philalethes is a good starting point. Any Lodge of Research, those are going to be good for individual study. If you want to be around guys that are talking about it, aside from obviously an affinity lodge, I'm talking about that. But look into the advanced degrees of the Scottish Rite or the York Rite, because they really granulate what your 3 degrees of craft masonry teach. And they within those bodies, you'll find other members who are also very much into esoterica, and so you'll find your group that way. Typically, you need to ask around. You keep asking that question, but every guy you come in contact with that's someone new that seems to have been down the road, bring it up to them. That's one of the nice things about Masonry is you can be free to express your interest, and someone will probably try to help you find the right path. So, but it varies from location to location, organization to organization. So he's in Florida, he would know the guys. In California, I would know the guys. Somebody around here could probably help guide you in the right direction.
Excellent.
Yeah, I'll add one more thing, and this is kind of a funny joke. We started the Boynton Esoteric Lodge of Research in Boynton Beach, Florida. The guy who started it, Scott Schwartzberg, really nice guy. One of our very first presenters was the guy who presented on the stoplight, red, yellow, green, and tried to make the connection that those had Masonic and esoteric meanings. And I went, I think it's just telling you to stop or go or caution. So some circles that you get into, the guys go down the rabbit hole, really go down the rabbit hole. So, some of the mainstream things like, the Lodges of Research, the things we're talking about, definitely a better place to start.
Yeah, and similarly, I had a guy tell me, when you look at the word Mason, the reason we're called Masons is M is for the many ways we help people. I'm like, okay, No, you went a whole different direction that has no historical basis. All but you'll find the right ones.
All good advice. Over here.
My name's Edwin Hart. I belong to Concordia Lodge number 67 in Jenkintown, Pennsylvania. I'd like to ask our brother magician, what is it about cups and balls that would choose one to pick that for a name? It seems like it's one of the first magical tricks you learn. I had the Marshall Brodeen plastic cups and balls.
Yep. How many have that one? Yeah.
And you see them with grapefruits and metal and clear. Penn and Teller last night, they were talking about their clear cups and balls that Teller did. I just wondered if you'd educate us about cups and balls. Well, and it has nothing to do with football.
Yeah. The first magic trick that was recorded historically, artistically, is a magician or someone with a cup and a ball, and it's in an Egyptian hieroglyph. You see it continued throughout history, and it's the most basic of the magic tricks. When you look at the cups and balls routine, the three cups and the three balls, that the reason that is a basic trick that if you're learning from another magician. The reason it's, I'm sorry, I keep puffing this thing. I'm sorry, guys. I know I'm driving you crazy in the back. The reason that we encourage younger magicians to learn that is all of the basic magic effects are embodied in that. The vanish of an object, the appearance of an object, a levitation, a suspension, they're all there. And you learn a lot of very important, not just sleights, because the mechanics of doing things are important, but the psychology behind it is important. Like, everyone's heard the phrase misdirection, and I don't use the term misdirection. I use the term direction. I direct your attention to where I want it to be so that, you know, I'm doing something over here, and over here I'm quietly sticking an elephant under something. So that the cups and balls is a very basic trick that teaches a lot of things. So when we as a group got together, we compiled a list of something like 90 possible names, most of which were absolutely insane. But when we got down to the last, well, we're magicians. When we got down to the last 12 or so, that one just jumped off the page, and we called it the cup and ball. Then Randy Brill came up with the idea, let's call it ye old cup and ball. And I had to explain that ye is actually the, and it's a historic art, blah, blah, blah. The bottom line is we ended up with cup and ball. I will say that I've had to remind the brothers to make sure you delineate those words clearly, because it's cup and ball. Otherwise, you know, do it in your own head. I've been asked that one a few times, but that's why the name of the lodge, and that's why the cups and balls is something you always associate with magicians. That and bad card tricks.
Great question.
I got a question here, Seth.
Go for it. From the internet?
Yeah, from me.
Oh, okay.
Brother Ralph, I think thank you for your program, and as well as you, Brother Brett. But this question is for Brother Ralph. Your presentation really had a twofold component. One about the very interesting elements of magic, but then really when you tied it into the value of the affinity lodges and using the magic lodge as an example. So the question I have for you is, I imagine Master Mason started the affinity lodge. When did it grow to the point where you were bringing in magicians and making them Masons in the affinity lodge?
That actually hasn't grown to that point, only because we have had interest now, but we've not had an actual petition from a non-Mason who is a magician who wants to join. Typically in an affinity lodge, what you'll find is as any lodge develops, you start with a group of guys, then you become a solid lodge, and eventually you'll have petitions come in. And if you're a small group, that's where you probably want to work in conjunction with another lodge to have them do some courtesy work or bring some other Masons in to do stand-in, because otherwise you have literally every member of your lodge taking an office. But if you're lucky, that could be a good thing. So we've been chartered for about a year and a half now, and we have not had a petition formally yet. I see one coming at our, believe it or not, next stated meeting. We'll have our first petition for degrees. Once chartered in California, we're chartered as a full craft lodge, so we have the ability to and the authority to confer degrees as well.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Seth, I'm going to ask a real quick question, Seth. We talked about this at lunch, so it may be. Remember we talked about, I asked you the question, how proficient do you have to be as a magician to join? Because what if you start like Epicurean Lodge and you're really interested in food? Well, I mean, I'm a horrible cook, but I love to eat even though I'm not huge. My wife feeds me very well, but she controls my portions. How do you make that delineation in these affinity lodges that might require a skill, not just like, oh, a rugby lodge or a baseball lodge or something?
Yeah, it's going to be a lodge-by-lodge kind of thing. I know that with the Cup and Ball Lodge, for example, we started with all guys who were very proficient magicians. And then someone had showed an interest that had a really in-depth knowledge of magic history and theory. And we wanted to be responsive to that and not miss out on that resource. Ultimately, we resolved on if they pass muster with our executive committee, then that's someone that we'll consider for membership. Not every lodge is going to be as hard or as soft. I mean, there are probably, I think it's Kansas that has the law enforcement lodge. And you have to be a member of the law enforcement community as they define it.
Right.
The Epicurean Lodge might be a place where it's people who love to cook or professional chefs. Or they may be a little more lax and say people who really love to eat, and then you can get in, you know. So it's decided on a lodge-by-lodge basis, but it's a narrower selection process than a typical craft lodge would be, although still within the principles of Masonic inclusivity.
Great question.
My name is Jack Harley. I'm with Effort of Lodge 665, and this question would be for Brett. Brett, I've noticed in all of the UGLE and Premier Grand Lodge and all of that iconography, there is always in their heraldry three castles. I can't get anybody, including Bob Cooper, to tell me what three castles those are. Do you have any idea? I know you said you wouldn't.
Yeah,
know.
Yeah. Remember, those are coming from the coat of arms from the original Worshipful Company of Masons, who were the bricklayers, the stonemasons, and so forth. So they sort of usurped that as theirs because we're the Freemasons. I don't know what castles those would actually depict. Now, if you really pressed me, I would probably say, well, okay, let me go back to the Garter King of Arms, and I don't even know who that is. I know who the Lord Lion is, but I don't know who Garter King of Arms is. And I'd say, hey, go back and look in the records and find out when that grant was made, and do they have any notations that they saved with it that these are three specific castles, or are they just three castles because you guys are cathedral builders or castle builders or whatever it is? But good question. That I couldn't answer.
Brett, if somebody were interested in obtaining arms, I know some folks have asked you that question individually. What's a resource that you could point
to? So for 99% of you, I'm going to say it's going to be kind of hard for you to trace your family tree unless you've already done that. Maybe in Pennsylvania it's not so hard because you guys keep good records. But if you can trace it back to somebody born in England, Scotland, Ireland, or Wales, you're halfway there, because then you just go to one of those heraldic authorities. I did that for my father. It was easy. I'm first generation in the United States, so it was really easy for me to go. The problem is, when I did it for my father, it was $3,000. Now, to go to Lord Lyon, it's around $10,000. To go to England, it's around $15,000. And you got to come with all the records. They don't do that for you. So it can be quite cost prohibitive to do that. The American College of Heraldry, you could, in theory, do the same thing, or say you came from Germany. Germany's great. I had a bunch of people coming up to me saying, oh, my family's from Germany. How do I do this? Unfortunately, back in the heraldic times that we all think of, they were largely principalities, so they did their own heraldry. There was no one central heraldic authority, and that makes it extremely hard to do it now. But let's just say you did. Let's say you had an ancestor from Germany that you knew this was their coat of arms, and you have your little depiction of where you are on that family tree. You could go to the American College of Heraldry. The person who's the president is David Wooten, really nice guy, a little eccentric, but very nice guy. And if you tell him, hey, here's this coat of arms, I'm here, he and the other heralds there know enough about English, Scottish, German, they know enough heraldry that they will cadence your coat of arms to show where you fall on that tree, that ancestral tree of yours, that'll be right, and they'll register it. And it's $400 or $350. You know, then from there, you can go to any heraldic artist, and they can draw a wonderful watercolor for you. You can pay $5,000 if you want. You can get herald banners made, flags made, seal rings, deck seals, anything you want, once you have the basic blazon, which is the description. So that would be my advice to the American College of Heraldry.
Thank you.
Hi. Bill Britton from Cumberland Valley Lodge 315. Just one question. It's a collective question for both of you to pull your resources here. But Is there any evidence of heraldry and magic? And if so, do you have an example of that?
Okay, I hate it when someone says, good question, to give them time to think. I'm not only doing that, I'm stalling before I say good question, because I'm really trying to work this one through. I am aware of having seen heraldic devices in magical families, but I have seen no magical symbolism in heraldic devices. So I guess the answer is no. I wish, now you got me something to think about, and I'm going to be looking it up, and I'll be talking to this guy about it.
Yeah, I can honestly say the only thing I would know would be if somebody was a magician and they had a coat of arms, either through grant or through matriculation, yes, then you could say they may incorporate it into one of the, you know, what do you call those, posters that would announce their magic show. Maybe it's somewhere buried or anything, but as far as a specific trick or magic thing, no. Maybe there are some magical associations that develop, just like you did with Pennsylvania, they develop a symbol, which is heraldic in itself, but not an official device that would have been granted from England, Scotland, Wales. They just adopted that as their own, and it's a registered trademark, and maybe somebody did the rules of heraldry, but it's not depicted on a shield or something.
And regrettably, I looked to see, and there is no worthy company of magicians in London. I hope there would be, because I thought that would be an easy in, but no luck on that one. I do know, and you mentioned advertising materials. If you go back to the early 19th century and late 18th century, you'll see some entertainers that would include Masonic symbols, however. So in that sense, sort of heraldic,
sure,
right?
Sure, sure.
Richard Potter was the first American-born huge entertainer. And this guy was a superstar. He was a member of a Prince Hall Lodge in Boston that became African number one. He was a freedman. He was African-American. When he toured in the South, he represented himself to be from from India. And when he was up in the North, he represented himself to be an African-American. But on his posters, you would commonly see a square and compass. He was a ventriloquist. He was a magician, and a bunch of different things. But the square and compass would be prominently displayed on his advertisements. At the time, a lot of times it was Masonic Lodge halls where traveling entertainers would book. And so if you trace his touring, you can see him hitting all the lodge halls in the South. And then there would be missed ones where they figured out what his background was, and he wasn't going to play that down. He would just move on to the next one. So.
Any other questions? Going once, going twice, one more here in the middle. Still a couple minutes left.
Okay. Dave Hallowell, 503 is my lodge in Wrightsville. Going back to you, I visited a town in Europe. That's a pretty bad start. I was in Holland, and there was a central square in Holland that, in the capital of Holland, whatever that is, if memory failed. But it was every guild was located there in the square, and everyone was taking pictures with their newfangled cameras. And I wondered if there might be some connection to the question of where is their information on these subjects.
You mean from a standpoint of where would you find heraldic information in Holland?
Yeah.
So
in the guild
sure,
square.
Sure. So again, a lot of these places, like if you said Sweden or Switzerland, Sweden and so forth, they still have a king. So there still is this. They don't necessarily have a heraldic authority that you or I could go to and petition, but they still keep records and so forth like that. Things in countries that are no longer a monarchy or even a principality, it's a little harder. You probably just have to look in historical records and so forth. Depending on what you're looking for, too, remember a lot of these things, and I forgot the brother, and I apologize, we were talking about, I think his brother, I can't remember your last name, but Ellis. In the United States, if you're in the military and you know somebody, or God forbid, you've received it, the Purple Heart. The Purple Heart has on it above the Purple Heart, or right on the apex of it, it's George Washington's coat of arms. So we take a lot of things that may have been to a specific person, and because that person was a prominent person, and it's not just here in the United States, that might have been some symbol that a town adopted a long time ago, and that's just sort of been incorporated into that family. Maybe has died off a long time ago, but those arms are now the city's arms. Or, I mean, here in Maryland, I mean, the arms of Maryland are from a British, I think it was an earl, a British earl, Fort Lauderdale, where I'm from. It's Lord Lauderdale, and the city arms incorporate this person's arms. So a lot of things that you see in cities, governments, or whatever around, it's probably an individual, or at worst, it's something that was a long time ago when they were part of a kingdom, that was their arms for that city or county or whatever.
One last question, anybody? All right, we'll call this the last one.
Yes, this is for Brett. Carl Wolf, I'm dual membership, 621 in Lehighton Lodge and 816 Elizabethtown Day Lodge. I'm also a member of the Masonic Village Hobby Shop. We're a bunch of wood butchers that put things together, and sometimes they come out the way we want them to. But anyway, it's a two-part question. The first part I remember, the second part, yeah, I don't know if I will, but that's why I live here.
Sure.
with the assumed arms, everybody here has a story, and part of the heraldry is you're telling your story through the expression of symbols. If someone would decide to create their own coat of arms and then produce it, sort of like a bucket, a bucket shop type of presentation.
Right.
Could you incorporate perhaps facets of a family coat of arms?
Sure.
I mean, even though you say it's not your coat of arms, it's a family coat of arms.
So, yes. So, first of all, there's a difference between bucket shop heraldry and assumed arms. Assumed arms happen all the time. As U.S. citizens, we don't have a place to have a grant of arms for us. So we're always assuming arms unless we can prove a lineage and go to that heraldic authority and show and they get granted or matriculated to us. So there's nothing wrong with assumed arms. The American College of Heraldry is great. They have people that if you have an interest in heraldry and you want something depicting you that then will be passed on to your family so that it's sort of that tradition, that's what they're there for. And the difference between assumed arms and like a grant or matriculated arms, if you go, like I mentioned, if you go to Scotland, you could have the best assumed arms, you could have it on your stationery, it could be for 20 years or 20 generations. If you go to Scotland and you go to a Highland Games and you want to hoist your flag, not that somebody's going to know, but if somebody did and they went, huh, if you can't show that those were granted to you or matriculated, they're going to say take those down because that they're not registered in Scotland, they're not from Scotland, take them down. So that's the difference between a grant and an assumed or matriculated arms. Everybody's in assumed arms. The first person who said, these are going to be my arms, the lion rampant is going to represent me, he just chose that. It's only because some governmental body, in this case, Lord Lion or the Garter King or the Coronista Rey in Spain or somebody went, oh, we will grant those to you under our official authority as king or representative of the king or the empire or whatever. So there's no shame in assumed arms, and if you're working with a true heraldic person like Dave Wooten at the American College of Heraldry, he's not going to let you assume too closely arms that can be mistaken for another family. So while you may say, oh, you know what, this family in Germany, it's this, I just want to add one little thing, he's going to say, no. We'll take one or two aspects of that, and we're going to rearrange them in a little so you can see the relationship, but we're going to make sure that anybody looking at this is not going to think you just grab this arms like bucket shop heraldry and are trying to make it you're a direct descendant. Because remember, there's a lot of people, Gordons, you know, you could have just been the lowest person, you know, shoveling the you know what in the middle of a field. You're not even a Gordon, you were just a vassal. But you took that name, your family took that name, and over years you became a Gordon. You have no blood relationship to the Gordons, but you have the same last name. So they're not going to allow you to have that direct descendant. I can't prove my lineage to the the head of the Gordon House, so that's why my three boar's heads are not in the same position as that person's. They're in a straight line. So hope that helps.
All right.
I was pleased to hear that you've almost got an affinity lodge going with tinkering, I think that was that what you said?
So something like that, yeah.
I was like, are you sure this is for Brett?
Well, again, we very much appreciate our two speakers for being here today. Do you have closing remarks that you want to share?
No, but I did notice you have one that's off topic, but I'll feel it, that's coming on the internet.
We'll call that the last one. Go for it.
Okay. The question was, I am interested in how we can use the esoteric teaching in engagement with our service to the community locally and globally. And I love this because everything about Masonry is to some degree esoteric. And everything about the esotericism of Masonry is about enhancing your wisdom and developing your compassion, developing your welcoming nature, making you a better human being. So by its very nature, the esotericism of Masonry, you don't need to get into the details of it. It's kind of like, how do you use math to do your taxes? It's an inherent part of it. Because you learned math, you can do taxes. Because you studied the esoterica of Masonry, you can engage with your community and you can serve your community locally and globally simply because you're a better man.
Here, here. Well said. Let's show our appreciation for our presenters today. Just a reminder that the wood shop is open from 2 to 4, so you got a little half an hour or so till the wood shop is open, and you can also stop up to the Masonic Village Farm Market, which is open until 3 o'clock. I know some of our presenter folk are looking forward to that.
Maybe we have a tour, yeah.
We thank you for being here with us today and supporting the Academy of Masonic Knowledge. We hope that you enjoyed the presentation. I'd like to invite Brother Austin Schifrin up to offer our closing prayer, and then we'll let you be on your way and enjoy a nice Saturday out there. Austin?
Folks, please stand and assume an attitude of prayer. God, thank you so much for bringing us together, for the gift of bringing us together today. We were educated, we were entertained, and we were blessed with each other's fellowship. Please grant us traveling mercies so that we may return home safely to our families and loved ones. All this we ask in your most holy name. Amen.
Go out and enjoy. Thank you, brothers.
Oh, I was just going to have us like sit behind the table, but we'll do whatever you want.
Yeah, that's great.
Yeah,
that's great.
Yeah, here. Yeah.